Hello all, welcome once again to my engineering physics channel. This is Sanjeev Bhade from KJ Somaiya Institute of Engineering and Information Technology. In this session, I am going to talk on nanotechnology. So these are the topics that we are going to cover in nanotechnology sessions. If we follow conventional method of teaching, it will need around 4 lectures. And marks weightage will be around 14 to 16. We will be first discussing what are the properties of nanomaterials. Then we will discuss one important parameter called surface to volume ratio. Then we will discuss two approaches used to produce nanomaterials, top down approach and bottom up approach. We will get introduced to three microscopes: scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscope and atomic force microscopes. And we will be discussing methods to synthesize the nanomaterials. Four methods we will be covering: ball milling method, sputtering method, vapor deposition method and Solgel method. After learning this, the student will be able to assimilate the wide scope of nanotechnology in modern developments and its role in the emerging innovating applications. We will be covering these topics in two sessions. In the first session, we will get introduced to the properties of nanomaterial, top-down approach and bottom-up approach, and methods to synthesize the nanomaterials. So these topics will be covered in the first session. And in the second session, we will discuss scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscope, atomic force microscope, and the applications of nanomaterials. In 1959, Nobel laureate Richard Feynman presented an idea of building materials atom by atom, and this idea evolved into a new branch of science which is called as nanoscience. So a nanoscience deals with building up complex materials and machines using fine control on the matter at the nanometer scale. So in nanoscience, we will be studying properties of the materials having the length scale of the order of few nanometers. Here is some comparison of sizes of different objects. A ball diameter can be measured in centimeters. Size of an ant can be measured in millimeters. Diameter of a hair around 100 micrometers. Size of a blood cell around 10 micrometers. Bacteria around 1 micrometer. Virus around 100 nanometers. DNA around 10 nanometers. Size of the molecules is around 1 nanometer. An atom is around angstroms, measured in angstroms, that is 0.1 nanometer. So in nanotechnology, we will deal with the materials in this size range, 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. So the materials having the size of this order will be studied in the nanoscience. To study the nanomaterials, we will need some tools and techniques that will be used for preparing the nanomaterial, for characterization of the nanomaterials and using the properties of nanomaterials in different applications. These tools and techniques involved in the preparation of nanomaterials, characterization of nanomaterials and using the properties of nanomaterials in different applications are collectively called as nanotechnology. So in nanotechnology, we are going to study the tools and techniques used for preparing the nanomaterials, characterization of nanomaterials and using their properties in different applications. Electron microscopes will be very important tools in the nanotechnology. Because nanoparticles are very small in size, we will not be able to see them with our eye, or even very high resolving power microscope, optical microscope, will not be able to show the nanoparticles to us. So we will need a very high resolving power microscope, and such microscopes are called as electron microscope. So in nanotechnology, we will be extensively using this electron microscope. So in this sessions, we will be discussing the construction and working of some of the electron microscopes: scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscope and atomic force microscopes we will be getting introduced to. It is observed that when the materials are reduced to the nanoscale, they showed different properties as compared to the properties exhibited by them at the bulk level or macro level. At nanoscale, for some materials, optical properties may change, thermal properties may change, mechanical properties may change, electrical properties may change, magnetic properties may change. And these new properties can be used in variety of applications in different fields. Like in food processing, we will find the applications, medicine, automobiles, pen technology, computer technology, robotics, space technology. So in all these fields, the new properties can be utilized. One of the important reason why the properties change when the materials are reduced to the nano scale is surface area to volume ratio. Now, surface area to volume ratio will increase if the size of the particles is reduced. And in nanomaterials, nanoparticles, this surface area to volume ratio is very, very large. Now, here is an example. This is a block, a cube having size 4 centimeter. If you calculate its surface area, it will be 4 into 4 into 6 faces. 4 into 4 will be the area of one face. Such a 6 faces will be there for this cube. So total surface area is 96 centimeter square. And volume of this cube will be 4 into 4 into 4. That is 64 cubic centimeters. If you cut this cube in 8 parts, each small cube will be of length 2 centimeters. Now the volume will not change. Volume of this 8 cubes will be 64 centimeter cube only. But see the surface area. Now the surface area will become 2 into 2 into 6. This will be the surface area of one cube, and such 8 cubes are there. So total surface area will now become 192 centimeter square. So what we can notice from here is, if you reduce the size of the cubes, then surface to volume ratio, surface area to volume ratio increases. 192 upon 64 will be large as compared to 96 upon 64. So surface area to volume ratio increases if you reduce the size of the particles. Now, atoms on the surface of the material are often more reactive than those in the middle, and therefore larger surface area means what? More number of atoms available for reactions, and therefore larger surface area means material is more reactive, and this will result in stronger forces of attraction between the surfaces when the material is reduced to the nanoscale. And this is one of the important reason why nanoparticles show different properties as compared to the larger particles of the same material. So material we are not changing, we are just reducing the size of the material to nanoscale, and the properties of the material will change. Properties of the material change when they are reduced to the nanoscale. For example, optical properties. Now, when light is incident on the material, it can be absorbed or scattered. And this absorption or scattering depends on the size of the material. If the size of the material is less than 20 nanometers, absorption of light is significant. And if the size is greater than 100 nanometers, then scattering is significant. So we can design the nanomaterials of different sizes in order to get optimal amount of absorption or scattering. And this may result in a different color for the particles of different sizes of nanoparticles. So some examples of change in optical properties when the material is reduced to the nanoscale are: opaque substances at bulk level become transparent at nano level. For example, copper. So copper is opaque at the macro level, and when it is reduced to the nanoscale, it becomes transparent. Glass is transparent at the bulk level. When it is reduced in the form of fine powder, it becomes opaque. Gold, if the size of gold nanospheres is of the order of 15 nanometers, then they will be green in color. Gold nanospheres of size 100 nanometers will appear orange in color, and at the bulk level, we know gold is yellow. Electrical conductivity of the material alters when it is reduced to the nanoscale. So, we can invent new nanomaterials having the desired conductivity. Some examples are ceramics. The electric conductivity increases with the decrease in size of the nanoparticle. Metals, electric conductivity decreases with the decrease in size of the nanoparticles. There is a change in magnetic properties also. Nanomaterials are usually more magnetic than the bulk materials. Even non-magnetic solids are found to show magnetic properties when reduced to the nanoscale. Magnetic properties change when the material is reduced to the nanoscale. Some examples: potassium, sodium are paramagnetic at the bulk level, become ferromagnetic at the nano level. Iron, cobalt, nickel, which are ferromagnetic at the bulk level, become super paramagnetic at the nano level. So, magnetic properties can also change when the material is reduced to the nanoscale. It is observed that when the materials are reduced to the nanoscale, they show different properties as compared to the properties exhibited by them at the bulk level or macro level. At nanoscale, for some materials, optical properties may change, thermal properties may change, mechanical properties may change, electrical properties may change, magnetic properties may change, and these new properties can be used in variety of applications in different fields. Like in food processing, we will find the applications: medicine, automobiles, pen technology, computer technology, robotics, space technology. When the material is reduced to the nanoscale, the mechanical properties like hardness, elasticity, adhesion, friction improve. Lubrication also improves at the nanoscales. Ductility of the nanomaterial may be high at high temperatures. So, these changed properties can be used in different types of applications. These are some more examples which will indicate the change in properties when the material is reduced to nanoscale from microscale. Copper, opaque at macroscale, become transparent at nanoscale. Platinum, inert at macroscale, become catalytic at the nanoscale. Aluminium, stable at macroscale, become combustible at nanoscale. Gold, solid at room temperature at macroscale, but when you reduce it to the nanoscale, it becomes liquid at room temperature. Silicon, insulator at macroscale, becomes conductor at nanoscale. So, in addition to this, there are many more materials which change their properties when they are reduced to the nanoscale. These are some of the examples. Now, we have understood that when the material is reduced to the nanoscale, its properties change. Now, let us see how to produce the nanomaterials. For producing nanomaterials, two approaches are used. One is called as top-down approach and the other is called as bottom-up approach. Now, top-down approach is a physical process, and in top-down approach, a large-scale object is taken and it is continuously reduced in size. So, a large-scale object is progressively reduced in dimensions. So, you can see here, this man is breaking this bigger rock into smaller and smaller particles. So, this top-down approach consists of ultra-fine micro-machining of materials using lithography, epitaxy or etching. This method is usually a time-consuming method and a relatively costly method. So, in short, in top-down approach, a material in bulk level is taken and it is cut into smaller and smaller pieces till we get nanoscale particles. Another approach used to produce nanomaterials is bottom-up approach. So in bottom-up approach, smaller and smaller particles are joined together to form a bigger structure. This bottom-up approach is usually a chemical process. Different materials and devices are constructed from molecular components on their own, which do not require any external agent to assemble them. These molecular components assemble themselves by recognizing the molecules of their own type. This bottom-up approach starts by collection and combination of atoms and molecules to build the complex structures. It consists of chemical synthesis, such as soft chemical methods and self-assembly of molecular structures. This bottom-up approach is relatively a cheaper approach. So you can see, in a bottom-up approach, atoms will come together to form the clusters, and clusters will come together to form the nanoscale particles. So two approaches can be used to produce the nanoscale materials: top-down approach or bottom-up approach. In top-down approach, we start from the bulk level material, and we reduce the dimensions by cutting the bulk level material into smaller and smaller pieces till we get nanoscale particles. And in bottom-up approach, atoms are brought together to form the clusters. Atoms and molecules are brought together to form the clusters, and these clusters come together to form the nanoscale particles. Now let us discuss some of the methods which are used to produce the nanomaterials. All these methods will either use a top-down approach or bottom-up approach. So first we will start discussion on mechanical method, which is called as ball milling method. Then we will go for physical vapor deposition method. These are physical methods. Then Solgel method and chemical vapor deposition methods. These are the chemical methods. The first method that we'll be discussing for producing the nanomaterials is ball milling method. Ball milling is a mechanical process that uses a top-down approach. So top-down approach means bigger size particles are reduced into smaller and smaller size. All the structural and chemical changes produced in ball milling method are produced by the mechanical energy. This ball milling method consists of balls and a mill chamber. This mill chamber is nothing but a stainless steel container, and in this stainless steel container, large number of small hardened steel balls or silicon carbide balls or tungsten carbide balls are kept. This container can be rotated, and as the container is rotated, these balls will continuously move. This rotating container is called as a mill, and as this container is rotated, the hardened steel balls, silicon carbide balls, tungsten carbide balls also rotate inside this mill. The powder of the material for which the nanomaterial is to be formed is kept inside this steel container. This powder will be made into nano size using this ball milling technique now. As the mill is rotated, this powder will be crushed into smaller and smaller and smaller size continuously. This silicon carbide balls or tungsten carbide balls or hardened steel balls will provide very large amount of energy to the material powder, and the powder gets crushed into smaller and smaller pieces. This process of ball milling is done approximately 100 to 150 hours to get uniform fine powder. So approximately 100 to 150 hours this mill will be rotated continuously. So this is a simple animation with the help of which we can understand the working of ball milling method. This container is continuously rotated, and as a result of this, the hardened steel balls or silicon carbide balls will move inside this container, and the powder for which the nanomaterial is to be formed is continuously crushed into smaller and smaller size. Using this ball milling method, nanopowder of 2 to 20 nanometer in size can be produced. The size of the nanopowder depends upon the speed of rotation of these balls inside the container. It is an inexpensive and very easy process. But the disadvantage is it takes large amount of time. So you, we have discussed 100 to 150 hours we need to rotate this mill in order to get uniform fine powder. Also, as the process is not very sophisticated and therefore the shape of the nanomaterials obtained will not be regular. So irregular nanomaterial, irregularly shaped nanomaterials will be obtained. There may be contaminants inserted from the balls and milling additives, because these balls are continuously striking this nanomaterial. Some atoms of these balls, hardened steel balls or silicon carbide balls, may get attached to the nanomaterial. So this method may produce the crystal defects. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of ball milling method. Another physical method that we'll be discussing for producing the nanomaterials is physical vapor deposition method. This physical vapor deposition can be achieved by two ways, a resistive method and a sputtering method. We'll be discussing each method one by one. This physical method vapor deposition uses a bottom-up approach. So smaller and smaller particles will be joined together to get bigger size nanomaterial. So in vapor deposition method, the material is evaporated inside the vacuum. Why inside the vacuum? In order to avoid the impurities. So the entire assembly will be kept inside the vacuum. So all the air from this chamber is taken out, so that there will be no air molecules that will get deposited on this substrate. The vapor particles travel towards this substrate, a cold target, and get deposited there. Once the vapor particles get deposited on this substrate, it is also called as a cold target. So once the vapor particles get deposited on the cold target, they will be condensed back into a solid state. Now for producing this vapor particles, we can use either a resistive method or sputtering method. In resistive method, the heat is generated using a resistive coil, high resistance coil. And this heat can be used to evaporate the material and producing the vapor of the materials. So you can see this is a high resistive coil which is connected to the power supply, and the material which is to be evaporated is kept on this coil. When we pass the current through the coil, due to high resistance, a large amount of heat is generated, and that heat is utilized in evaporating the material. And as the material is evaporated, the vapor particles will move in all the directions, and the vapor particles that are going in the upward direction will be deposited on this cold target, which we call as substrate. So in resistive method physical vapor deposition, we are using high resistance coil for producing the heat which is used to evaporate the material. So this is another method of vapor deposition, which we are calling as sputtering method. So it is also a bottom-up approach. In this case also, the material is evaporated inside the vacuum, so vacuum chamber is used. Why vacuum chamber? Because we don't want any air molecule to get deposited on the substrate, so all the air molecules are removed first. The vapor particles will travel towards the cold target, which we are calling as substrate, get deposited there and condense back into a solid state. Now the difference is how these vapor particles are produced. In resistive methods, we used high resistance coil to produce the heat which is used to vaporize the material. Here we will bombard the material, target material, with high speed electrons. High speed electrons. So high speed electrons are produced with the help of electron gun. These high speed electrons are made to strike the target material. So the energy of these high speed electrons will be used to evaporate the materials now. So the atoms are ejected from the solid target due to bombardment of the target by energetic electrons. So electron gun will emit the electrons, and these electrons are directed towards the target material with the help of this magnet. So a magnetic field is used to change the direction of electron beams so that the electrons will strike the target material. So in sputtering method, high speed electrons striking the target materials produce the energy which is used to evaporate the materials. Once the material is evaporated, the vapor particles travel towards the cold target, which we are calling as substrate, and get deposited there. And once they get deposited on this substrate, they will condense back to the solid state. Another method of producing nanomaterials is a Solgel method. Solgel method is a chemical process that uses a bottom-up approach. A sol is a type of colloid in which solid particles are suspended in a liquid. These particles are very small in size. So sols are actually heterogeneous mixtures. The particles are so small that gravitational forces do not exist for them. Only van der Waal forces and surface charges are present. When the solvent from the sol is evaporated, what remains behind is a semi-rigid mass. This semi-rigid mass is called as a gel. When the solvent is evaporated, the particles or ions left behind begin to join together in the form of a continuous network and form a gel. So here we have a sol, a type of colloid in which solid particles are suspended in a liquid. When the liquid is evaporated, what remains is a semi-rigid mass, which we call as a gel. So in a gel, the particles or ions left behind join together to form a continuous network. In order to get gel-like properties, significant amount of fluid need to be removed, and this can be accomplished by sedimentation process or centrifugation process. The remaining liquid is removed by using a drying process, and what we get is a dried gel. For this, a thermal treatment is often necessary. This may further enhance the mechanical properties of the structure's stability. This dried gel is grinded to get fine powder, and after that further processing is done by sifting, and then we will get a final product. This final product can be deposited on a substrate to form a film, or cast into a suitable container with desired shape, or used to synthesize the powders. Solgel process is a bottom-up process. Its advantages are: it is very cheap and low temperature technique. It allows fine control on the product's chemical composition. With this technique, we can add small quantities of dopant also, which are uniformly dispersed in the final product. Rate of reaction can be easily controlled by maintaining the suitable temperature. So these are the advantages of Solgel method. Another method used for producing the nanomaterials is chemical vapor deposition method. It uses a bottom-up approach. A reaction chamber is used for this process. In this chamber, the reactant gases are introduced. These gases react with the substrate and decompose on the surface of the substrate to form a film of nanomaterial. So first, predefined mix of reacting gases are introduced at a specified flow rate into this reaction chamber. This gas moves towards the substrate. The reactant gets adsorbed on the surface of the substrate and undergo chemical reactions there. So on after the chemical reaction, a film of nanomaterial is formed on the surface of the substrate. In this chemical reaction, some byproducts may be formed. These byproducts are dissolved and evacuated from the reaction chamber. So for evacuating these byproducts, a carrier gas flow is maintained through the reaction chamber. To avoid undesired chemical reactions, the substrate surface temperature, deposition time, pressure, and type of surface is carefully selected. This chemical vapor deposition can be used to produce high purity, high performance solid materials. So this is an advantage of chemical vapor deposition method. With this method, we can get the materials of high purity and high performance. So we are at the end of session 1 on nanotechnology. In this first session, we discussed what is nanotechnology, then we discussed properties of the nanomaterials, and we discussed various methods of producing the nanomaterials. In the next session, we will be discussing different types of microscopes used in nanotechnology: scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscope, and atomic force microscope. And at the end, we will be discussing applications of nanotechnology in different fields. So I hope you must have enjoyed these sessions. If you like this session, then please subscribe to the channel. I will be uploading more and more videos of engineering physics topics in this particular channel. If you have any queries, if you have any doubts, you can contact me on my WhatsApp number, or you can communicate with me through Google Classroom. So thank you once again.